so I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the school. My name is Ruben Miller. I'm an assistant professor of social work here at the University of Michigan. And I'd like to also thank the sponsors of this event today, Healing Communities, the Episcopal Church, the Incarnation, the Church of the Good Shepherd, UCC, St. Mary's Church in Chelsea, St. Francis of Assisi Church, Challenging Racism and Social Justice Council of the First Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Ann Arbor, the Juvenile Justice Clinic at the University of Michigan Law School, Students Organized Against Prisons, Friends of Restorative Justice in Washtenaw County, and Interfaith Council for Peace and Justice. I'd like to give a shout out to Craig, who will be videotaping the event, and Mary and Brian Miller, who put the programs and flyers and petitions together and donated printing costs. I'll be working with my dear friend Joe Summers, our dear friend Pastor Joe Summers from the Episcopal Church of the Incarnation, and of course extending a hearty welcome also from the School of Social Work, where we believe in this stuff, right? Where we believe in justice. And so anyway, my job is to do this welcome and also to talk about the importance of this topic, this conversation, and really this time in our history. And so just something to note is that we live in strange and marvelous times. The prison has really returned to the forefront of the public imagination in a way that was unforeseen just 20 to 30 years ago. I mean, so 20 or 30, 40 years ago, in the 1960s and 70s, folks were questioning whether or not, the late 1960s, people were questioning whether or not the prison was something that we actually needed anymore, right? Like, do we need a prison? The population was a steady 380,000, somewhere around the late 1970s. And today we know that the prison population itself is over 2.2 million. But something to think about as well is not just the prison population itself, but just the vast number of folks who are on probation and parole. And so that figure increased from 1977, where there was 1 million people on probation and parole, to today, where there's 5 million people on probation and parole. We haven't even talked about the number of folks who cycle in, out of jails, right? If we think about the number of people who are annually processed through jails each year, this is somewhere around 12 million people. Right? Nor the 19.8 million people who have a felony conviction marked by a criminal record that relegates them to cycles of poverty and disparity. We haven't yet discussed the egregious racial and ethnic disparities, right? The disparities based on race and ethnicity that happens. And this is largely due, I would argue, to the overwhelming concentration of criminal justice interventions within the, quote, inner city. This is the way we understand risk, how we understand danger. And so we concentrate police and courts and even well-meaning prison reentry organizations, these sorts of things, inside the inner city itself, creating a cycle, right? Where men who have been criminalized, women who have been criminalized are trapped, never able to leave. They are arrested from, returned to, and rehabilitated all within low-income spaces, like the ones they call home, because this is obviously a very transient population. And so, we couldn't have a more important conversation, right? And we're not the only ones who think so. The president visited a prison, right? This is glorious. It's a glorious time, right? The Koch brothers, right? And Van Jones are working together to do criminal justice reform. This is a glorious time. And if we're going to address this massive problem that was the result of policy decisions, we have to make decisions in ways that will reverse them, that will restore the dignity and humanity of the folks that we have indeed criminalized. This isn't to say that folks that have been criminalized have done nothing wrong, right? We're not naive, yes? Hence, while we think about ways to restore, to think carefully about the hurts that folks have caused, and to give folks an opportunity to make good. And so, with that, I just like to say I'm so pleased. I'm so pleased to be here tonight. I'm so pleased that you're here tonight, and I'm so pleased that we're having this conversation at this historic moment. So I'd like to bring up Joe Summers, who's gonna take it from here.
So 10 years ago, I helped organize the prisoner reentry program for Washtenaw County. And after working on that program for 10 years, I'm now shifting from the back end of the system to the front end of the system. And that's partly because while the Michigan Department of Corrections has committed itself to a restorative justice model, however imperfectly it's doing it, it's at least committed itself that direction, most of the rest of our justice system is still operating on the basis of a punitive justice system. And we'll not be able to overcome the evil of mass incarceration unless we establish county-based restorative justice systems. And I do want to recognize that this evil of mass incarceration we've come to recognize as the new Jim Crow system of our era. So it's just absolutely vital that we dismantle it. One of the obstacles we face in the struggle is what I would call objective cynicism. The idea that how we are doing things is basically the only way they can be done. And that's why when Fred Van Loo came to talk to our community almost 2 years ago, it had such a catalyzing effect. Because we could not only hear from Fred all sorts of things that might be possible, we heard about things that were actually being done in other places and the incredible difference those things were making. Since Fred's visit, we've made significant progress in some areas, such as the Peace Court that Judge Connors has set up, all the work the Dispute Resolution Center has been doing to train people in conflict resolution. Brenda Doolin and Janelle, are you here right now? Wave your hands, so anybody who wants to connect with them. The restorative justice work that's being done in area high schools that we learned this past week has cut in half the number of school suspensions over the last 2 years, and that's a key part of breaking up the school-to-prison pipeline. Judge Connors' court joins the Veterans Court, the Mental Health Court, the Drug and Alcohol Court as courts which are concerned with restorative justice practices. But I still have to say that for the most part, the vast majority of serious criminal cases, in this county, there's no real restorative justice, no real concern shown for the restoration of crime victims, no real intervention to help those who have harmed others figure out what needs to be done so this doesn't happen again. We're here tonight to build a movement to create a county-based restorative justice system here in Washtenaw County. If you're interested in this effort, we hope you'll fill out the form in your program and put it in one of the baskets as you leave. If you like what you hear tonight, please consider signing the petition to support restorative justice in Washtenaw County. It will be sent to our county commissioners and our district attorney's office. We also hope you'll join us for the next forum in this series, which will be on Thursday, November 19th at the School of Social Work. There's posters about it up there. It'll feature Dennis Trantz talking about how to bring an end to mass incarceration in Michigan. Dennis was the first executive director of community corrections in Michigan. He was the architect of Michigan's very successful prisoner reentry program, and he's currently the director of the Michigan Council on Crime and Delinquency. So that should be a dynamite night. Lastly, in case I forget, Nicola's books, we're glad they're here. They have some of Fred's books and some other books on restorative justice. Fred will be glad to sign his books after the talk, and hope you'll stop by there and take a look at them. But rather than cut into Fred's time to talk, let's just welcome Fred Van Loo.
Needless to say, it honestly is a real honor to be here. And I'm moved, and I so appreciate the tone that has been set, because that's where we are in our history right now. And I'm somewhat slow to getting there. And first, a couple of confessions. I'm a recovering lawyer, and trying to recover from having been a prosecutor about 25 years. For a long time, I thought I was doing the right thing, even as I called myself a restorative justice prosecutor. And we'll talk about that and some good things were done, and I think things that may be instructive for you here. But I want to sort of start a little bit at the end for me, just in my own journey. About 4 years ago, 5 years ago, I retired. thinking, went back to graduate school to study conflict transformation, and I wanted to work overseas. And I was taking an advanced course, I forget the title, but it was like Advanced Issues in Restorative Justice from Howard Zaire. I always called him the godfather of restorative justice. I think other people call him the grandfather of restorative justice. Anyway, Howard is the man that pretty much started restorative justice in this country in the mid to late 70s, a program in Elkhart, Indiana called PACT. Howard started that along with Mark Umbright, who's now at the University of Minnesota, and a couple of other people. And if you talk to Howard today, he'll tell you he didn't know what they were doing, and but they did something right. And it has become a movement. But I was taking that class 4 years ago this past winter, and great conversations. But I happened to go to the First Unitarian Church in Des Moines on a February Sunday, and Pastor Mark Stringer gave a sermon on the new Jim Crow. And I had not heard about the book yet. But of course, I had to go out and buy it the next day, or at least ordered it from Amazon the next day. And it's one of those things, as Cornell West says in the either the foreword or the introduction, once you've read the new Jim Crow, you've crossed the Rubicon. And just about anybody I've ever talked to about who's read the new Jim Crow would say the same thing. And so I began to struggle with, what does restorative justice have to say about mass incarceration? And restorative justice for me has always been a very personal thing because it involves people and relationships and broken relationships and addressing those harms and broken relationships in a way that our system has never done before and still, for the most part, does not do. And so, for the most part, at least in my own experience of doing restorative justice since 1991, I've been looking at it at the micro level, I guess you might say. Small, quiet rooms, confidential meetings, facilitators, people in pain. And I had not stepped back to look so much at our systemic problems. I knew we had a lot of people in prison. I knew that, bias drives a lot of the way justice is done, but I didn't really consider it deeply until I read Michelle's book. And even more so, about 2 months later, I was riding back from Virginia and I downloaded the Audible of the new Jim Crow, and I got so sick I had to pull off the interstate. It's that compelling. So that's one of my own struggles, is what does restorative justice going forward, what does it have to say about mass incarceration, about our broken system. And so that's just something for you folks to think about. Maybe you're already thinking about it. And if you're thinking about how you align with the system as you go forward with your work, that's a real, it's a serious thing to consider. But so I'm going to jump back a little bit. And I guess a show of hands. First of all, I asked Joe, are these the people that come, are they going to know a lot about restorative justice, a little bit, sort of a mixed bag? And so just a show of hands, if you think, you know a fair amount about restorative justice, and nothing to be embarrassed about, good. So at least half. And so not so much restorative justice 101, but I do want to go back to my first acquaintance with it. Because it's a way for me to review how we got to have a county-based restorative justice system. I never thought I'd be a prosecutor. I went to, I read Clarence Darrow when I was a kid, and I assumed I would be an attorney for the damned. And that's what I went to law school for, and that's what I hoped to be. Got out of law school, went to work at the Iowa Attorney General's office, and they put me in the Environmental Law Division protecting squirrels. And I wasn't quite ready. I was young and I wasn't ready to do that work yet. So and I got a call to be a prosecutor. And it was a call out of nowhere. And I thought, well, I'll do that for a couple of years because I can get trial experience. And I did. It was a great opportunity to become a trial lawyer at a young age, and I left that after 2 years, because back in the 80s, we didn't really have career prosecutors so much. We didn't have people that started out when they're 25 and, you know, hung on for 30 years so they could get that good government pension. You know, back then it was get your trial work and then go out and do some real work. And so I went to legal aid after that for a couple of years, and then taught law school and had my own private criminal practice. And then I got a call in 1990 from a newly elected county attorney, and he actually was the man that I worked for at the Attorney General's office. And he called apologetically, actually, and he said, "Fred, I'd like you to come to work for me. I'd like to be a bureau chief, but I've already given away the two litigation bureau chief positions, and I'm sorry to say I have a third one left, and it's overseeing the intake and screening of all the criminal cases in the office. And would be interested." And there was something in me that I was not an administrator at all. In fact, I'm sort of anti-administration, anti-system kind of thing. But something in me suggested, there's some raw material in all these cases, you know. And I had no idea what to do with them. But I took the job, sort of on faith, I guess. And started January of 1991. And within 6 months, I was ready to quit. It was the most depressing period of 6 month period since having been admitted to the bar about 10 years earlier. And because I was at the top of this machine, right? It's a machine. And it was not to say that there wasn't some good work being done and some justice being done to some extent, but it was a machine. And there was no meaning in it, for me at least. For other people, perhaps not for me. And I was just about ready. Honestly, I was within a week of quitting. I talked to my wife about quitting. And I got a letter from a minister friend of mine. He and I had done some work with some other people in the mid to late 80s when I was at legal aid doing homeless litigation. And he said, "Fred, you got to find out about this thing called restorative justice." And I'd never heard of it. In fact, the two words didn't seem to go together. So I read on, and he, what he told me about, and what he did was he included in his letter and an account of the Kitchener, Ontario annual, or the Ontario, Canada annual Restorative Justice Conference. And it was in Ontario, Canada that Restorative Justice got started, or at least the Caucasian version of Restorative Justice got started in North America. In the mid-70s, Kitchener, Ontario, a couple of the juvenile court officers, or probation officers. And so that caught on in Ontario, and at least appeared that they had annual conferences. And I'll never forget, the keynote speaker in the address that I had in my hand said, "We will have a restorative justice system in 100 years. And that was really intriguing to me. Number one, for somebody to have that kind of optimism. And number two, it actually takes a little bit of pressure off. It's not like we're going to have one in 15 years or 20 years, and you got to get a lot of work done in 20 years. And I thought, this is worth looking into. And I was thinking the other day, actually, about that in preparation for coming. And I can't recall how I researched restorative justice back then, because obviously we didn't have Google. And I don't know how I researched it, but I found out about this guy, Howard Serre, and his book, Changing Lenses. And I'm sure some of you have read Changing Lenses, right? Raise your hand if you have. Okay. It's, I consider it the Bible, the Old Testament of restorative justice. And it's a fascinating book, and it changed my life as a prosecutor and even as a person, I would say, as an individual. But just quickly, and I'm not here to sell Howard's books, although he did write the foreword to my book, so I should plug his book too. The 25th anniversary edition came out in May. It's a beautiful book, actually. I'm actually teaching an online restorative justice class to some at-risk kids using Howard's book as the primary text. But anyway, Howard is a PhD criminologist, Mennonite, and also a professional photographer. And so thereby comes the title, Changing Lenses. He said, you know, we've been looking at wrongdoing through the wrong lens in this country for a long time. We've been looking at it through a retributive or a punitive lens. And he said, we need to put a different lens on. We need to look through the lens of reparation, of healing. And it just blew me away. You know, I don't think consciously I'd ever thought that way. I mean, there's something about it that said, yes, absolutely, this is true. And having worked with crime victims primarily in the middle 80s and then going back to this new position, I knew they weren't happy. They didn't get the satisfaction they thought that they would get out of the offender being sent to prison. And but they didn't know what it was that they weren't getting, you know. And I didn't know what it was that they weren't getting until I read Changing Lenses, and then it clicked. They need to be healed, and they need to come into contact. Oftentimes, I'm not saying you're every single case, but oftentimes they need to meet the person who caused them harm. And I really like it now. Actually, people begin to actually. Not using the terms victim offender so much, at least in conversations like this, let's not use the word victim, it's a little more wordy, but let's just say the person who was harmed instead of victim, and let's say the person who caused the harm instead of labeling the victim and offender. But back then, we were using victim offender. And at the time, one of my duties was to oversee the Polk County Neighborhood Mediation Center. This is in Des Moines, Iowa. Polk County is about the size of, how do you say, Washington? How do you say the county?
Washington.
Yeah. About the same size county, right? We're about 400,000. Same, pretty similar size. So we got some similarities in terms of size. And so we had a pretty vibrant neighborhood mediation center, but doing the usual sort of like barking dog loud music, like tree line dispute kind of thing. And nothing that really impacted on the system. And so I called our people together and I said, there's this guy, there's this book, there's this thing called Restorative Justice, and what would you think about reading this book together? So we ordered 25 copies and had a little book club, for about a month, and said, we're going to do this stuff. We're going to do this. And we brought Mark Umbright in to do a 3-day training to facilitate. Back then it was called Mediate, victim offender meetings. And it just grew organically. And within the system, I was an assistant prosecutor, second in charge of an office of about 40 prosecutors. And we actually, to tell you the truth, we did it sort of like under the radar initially, because there's nobody to say you could or couldn't do it. And there was no law to say that you could or couldn't do it. Here's just this process, And having been in the system for a little while, I could see where we fit in the process. And where we fit is anywhere. You can do it anywhere. You can do it, diversion. You can do it pre-charge. You can do it between charge and arraignment, between arraignment and plea, between plea and sentence, post-sentence. You can do it anywhere, and you can do it on. And I'm jumping ahead a little bit. There are no offenses in which you can't do it. Although we never did actually do it on domestic abuse cases. We were actually charged as domestic abuse. So that's. Although some really good stuff's being done in the area of domestic abuse, both restorative justice processes, the restorative processes. But aside from domestic abuse, over 25 years, we've done with every level of offense from shoplift to homicide. And you've probably seen, read accounts, maybe have been involved in restorative processes with surviving family members of a homicide. But we started, we started small, and we had a, he's still the county attorney, and there's similarities between your county attorney, from what I understand, and our county attorney. He's run unopposed since 1990. I'm not sure when the county attorney was elected here. Has a pretty, has has his own way of looking at things. I'm trying not to offend anybody here. But to his credit, he said, go ahead and try it, but I don't want it to end up in the newspaper. Whatever you do, whatever this thing is, don't have it blow up. So I started looking, okay, so what are the crimes that least likely to have a blow up? So I took 20 unemployment fraud cases that we got from the State Department of, I was called the State Department of Inspections and Appeals. And prosecutors hate those cases anyway. They're all paper, and there's no blood and guts, they tend to sit around, and they're in yellow folders, and they get divvied out amongst the felony prosecutors, and you can go by the cubicle of a prosecutor and see a couple of these yellow folders, and they've never been opened by the prosecutor. They hate doing those cases. So I said, you know what, I'm going to take 20 of those, and we're going to see what happens to bring the person who committed this offense together with who's the victim, right? State of Iowa, people of Iowa. And in this case, the representative of the state was the investigator on the case. And over like 2 weeks, we did 20 of these victim offender meetings in this case. It was amazing. It was amazing what came out. The ability of the offender to tell story, their story, even the investigator, talking about their work on these cases. And so we had 20 successful resolutions that ended up in agreements that were presented to the court, and we reduced the charges from felonies to misdemeanors, and they got put on probation, deferred judgments, no record, with payment plan, And it was really pretty a nice, tidy way to resolve a lot of cases at one time. So I went back to my boss, the county attorney, and I said, John, it works. We've done 20 of these, and can I do some on where there's a human being as a victim? It's okay, we started with minor thefts and assaults, property damage, and really, it doesn't make any difference what the level of the offense is. It's the harm that's experienced by the intrusion, right? And that's what I learned pretty early on, is the sense of violation that can be experienced by someone harmed on offenses that a lot of times people sort of poo-poo, but you can't go there. Because crime, no matter what it is generally an intrusion on somebody's life. They experience, their worldview changes, right? Their way of being in the world is not safe any longer, And they don't look at the world the same. And, a burglary. I mean, burglary is one of the more intrusive crimes. And I've done under 150 burglary victim offender meetings. And they're all the same and they're all different. But what's the same is the world isn't a safe place anymore. And that's a huge... That's a greater loss than anything that was taken, right, in the burglary, is taking the way of, and particularly when they're children. When they're children that live in the home that was burglarized, and now they can't sleep alone any longer. They can't sleep at night. The slightest noise wakes them up, and they got to go sleep with mom and dad, and they got to put, install an alarm system, locks on the doors, and all that kind of thing. They don't go out at night like they used to, So that's what pulled me into restorative justice, was just seeing what I began to see was the need of, first of all, the need of victims to tell their story to the person who caused the harm, to sit right across the table. And back then we weren't doing circles, accountability circles. A lot of that work's being done now, and it's wonderful work. Back then it was strictly the traditional victim sits across the table from the offender. And each person can have a support if they want, need one. And a highly trained, non-judgmental facilitator. And It's just to try to just have you pictured, and it's important to have a visceral, I think it's important to feel viscerally this stuff. You know? But just to try to describe it, so you really just say you've got a young mom who's she's got three children, and house is broken into while they're out, they've gone to a movie, and they come home, and the house is sort of turned upside down, and some family heirlooms perhaps damaged or whatever, and she comes in the house with her children, and they see this. And the opportunity is given for them to meet the person who caused this, and to have the opportunity to just say it, to just say, you know, let me tell you how my life is different now, and how it's different for my children. And that's the first part of it. I mean, that's the initial healing, is just the telling of that story. But then the next thing that happens is the young person, or whoever they are, but oftentimes young, they're 14, 15, 25, 26, most crimes are committed in that age group, to have them take that story in, right? Have it really get into them, get under their skin, get into their souls, you know? So that's the second part of it. And then the third part of it is the person harmed, the victim, seeing the offender, getting it. And that's where the magic, it's almost a religious experience to see this sample play out. And like to say, they're all the same and they're all different. But if you give it time, you know, there can't be any timeline on this, right? I mean, if it's 2 hours, it's 2 hours. If it's 3 hours, it's 3 hours. Whatever it takes. And then there's that added component to it that these people who are hurting. And the victims are hurting, and the offenders are hurting as well. I mean, so often, almost overwhelmingly, in my experience, offenders want to apologize, and the system doesn't let them. They want to express remorse, and there's no avenue for that in the normal process of the criminal case, right? Because you're a defendant, you know, you're on the defense, you got to keep quiet, you know, you're protected by rules, which is all well and good. That doesn't do a whole lot for your need to say, I'm sorry. But this allows it. I wonder, if you don't mind, I'd like to read one account of this, and it's this book. It's called The Justice Diary, The Inquiry into Justice in America. And by the way, this came about, I was taking my last class in conflict transformation, and Howard Zier was an independent study, or I asked him, Howard, can I do an independent study? I need 3 more hours. He says, oh, absolutely. And we have been... for his advanced issues in restorative justice class, we were blogging every week on the readings and on the conversation. And I sort of got into the blogging thing. Never thought I would. Thought I was too old to be a blogger. But I really enjoyed it. And I said, Howard, you know, my kids are all gone. I'd like to travel around the country for a year or so, just talking to folks about their experience with the justice system. And what would you think if I blog? The conversations I had, and sitting in courtrooms, talking to police, talking to people that just got out of prison, talking to victims, whatever. He said, oh, that's good. So we drew a contract, and I agreed to do 150 blogs. That was going to be my thing. And so I ended up doing about 180 of them, and he said, well, Fred, you know, you've done that much. Why don't you put that into a book? So fortunately, I found a really, really good editor, and the editors are priceless, and she did the proverbial turning a sow's ear into silk purse, I think. But the reason I give you that little bit of history is one of the blogs I wrote for Howard was about a case that I had in 1994, early on in my journey, my restorative justice journey. But this case is one that really, even after 3 years of doing the work, really sold me on its efficacy and convinced me that there's really no other way to do justice but restorative justice. And so I wrote a blog about it, and Howard said, you need to publish that. And so I sent it to the Des Moines Register, and they made it the front page of the Sunday Opinion section. And out of that, I became a community organizer. And that's another story. But so I'll just read this to just hopefully you can begin to feel this stuff if you don't already. Members of the Temple B'nai Jeshurun woke on a Saturday morning to find neo-Nazi graffiti scrawled on the side of their synagogue. There were no suspects, but there was anger and outrage. At one level, the incident was a galvanizing experience, bringing together the broader religious community in a way never witnessed in Des Moines. At another, however, it brought forth shadows normally hidden within many good and well-intentioned people. Some cried out for a justice like that sought by vigilantes and lynch mobs. 2 weeks later, an 18-year-old boy and a 17-year-old girl, boyfriend and girlfriend, were charged with felony criminal mischief. I held on to the case rather than assigning it to a felony prosecutor. And I called Stephen Fink, the rabbi at the temple, asking how he was doing and how members of the temple were doing. He told me he was angry, that others were angry and afraid. I asked if he'd ever heard of restorative justice, and then I described its potential for healing. I asked if he would consider meeting with the young offenders. He said my description of restorative justice made sense to him and that it was consistent with his tradition. But in this instance, he thought that neither he nor temple members would consider meeting the offenders. I thanked him for his time, gave him my number, and encouraged him to call if he had a question. He did, a week later to the day. Rabbi Fink told me there had been much discussion following our phone conversation. He said there were some temple members who saw the wisdom of a meeting, and others who said a meeting would be used to minimize the harm done, and result in the offenders receiving just a slap on the wrist. But in the end, a consensus was reached that the temple should go forward with the meeting, even in the face of uncertainty and possible re-victimization. It was agreed that an evening meeting would take place at the synagogue. The people representing the interest of the temple at large would be the rabbi, two Holocaust survivors who had gone into hiding following the graffiti desecration of the synagogue, a former member of the Israeli army, and three temple elders. The young offenders would be accompanied by their attorneys. I would be present in my role as prosecutor, and an experienced mediator would facilitate the conversation. The evening came, we found ourselves seated around a large conference table at the synagogue. Low lighting and centerpieces made of candles and flowers set a tone appropriate for the seriousness of the gathering. Following the requisite introductions, an explanation of the process, and the signing of a confidentiality agreement, the stories began. They flowed out, hesitatingly at first, and then in a rush, with tears, anger, and fear. Old memories were resurrected. The tales of childhood nights in concentration camps rose to the surface. Stories were told of the struggle to survive, to grow up, to make a life, to raise a family, despite the scars and the nightmares. This night, for everyone present, there was no escaping what had happened 50 years earlier, in a foreign land to those who had died and to those who had survived. The offenders had stories of their own. The young man, 18 years old but looking only 12, had run away from home 2 years earlier. He'd been abused physically and emotionally by his stepfather. He suffered from a hearing loss and a speech defect. He was taunted at school. He made his way to Alabama. Members of the Aryan Nation admitted him to their school, where for months he was indoctrinated in the ways of bigotry and hate. His education completed, he left the school and made his way back to Iowa, where he hoped to recruit and nurture his own community of neo-Nazis. His success was limited. His only recruit was the girl who fell under the spell of his vision. The two came up with a plan to spread their message and draw attention to their cause. The synagogue was a logical target. The gulf between the experiences of the synagogue members and the teenagers was wide. But over the course of the evening, as people exchanged stories, the gulf narrowed. Self-awareness gave way to awareness of others. For the young man, pictures of Jews from photo albums he had studied at the Aryan Nation School were replaced by faces of wisdom and suffering. The temple members, slowly at first, came to see the offenders for what they were: lost, abused, and frightened children. Early calls to throw the book at the two gave way to compassion and understanding that there must be a better way. One of the Holocaust survivors asked the young man what he wanted from the temple members. He replied that he wanted forgiveness, Rabbi Fink, who had been silent for much of the evening, spoke. He said that in his tradition, the tradition of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, forgiveness had to be earned, and in this instance, nothing had been done to earn it. He spoke of atonement and its importance to the Jewish community. He said if the two were to atone for their transgressions, then and only then forgiveness would be possible. And so it was in the context of atonement that the victims and the offenders came together in an effort to construct a plan to make it possible for forgiveness to be earned. The temple members wanted the two to succeed, to earn their way out of the guilt that had overtaken them that evening. Following a dialogue befitting the tradition the synagogue honored, the victims and the offenders decided together that the two teenagers would each perform 200 hours of service, 100 under the supervision of the temple's custodian, and 100 with Rabbi Fink, meeting weekly to study Jewish and Holocaust history. Also, the temple would help the young man find a hearing specialist. The young man would have his Nazi tattoos removed, and both teenagers would obtain job-seeking skills, psychological assessments, and their GED. It was agreed that a second meeting would be held in 6 months. If the two had atoned in the manner agreed to, forgiveness would be given, and the temple, through Rabbi Fink, would recommend that the criminal charges be dismissed. In the best biblical tradition, it all came to pass. The young man and young woman worked hard, exceeding the expectations of the custodian and Rabbi Fink. They gained confidence in themselves as a result of their physical and intellectual labors and from establishing new relationships. They passed their high school equivalency exams, secured employment, got married, and had a child. The rabbi and the custodian were invited to their wedding, which the custodian was able to attend. The temple gave the young couple a wedding gift. 5 years later, at a gathering of restorative justice practitioners, supporters, and police, Rabbi Fink held back tears while speaking of the two young offenders who had become his friends. And again, I had seen the power of restorative processes before this. But this particular case convinced me that if we can do it in this case, when can't we do it? So that's the challenge, right? Why would we do it any other way? Why would we have a justice system that doesn't? It's just a matter of will, right? And mobilizing resources, and but there really is no better way to do it. So in our county, Polk County, the first 3 years, as I said, were somewhat under the radar. And I hope that doesn't sound like too long. We began to get the attention of the judges who wanted to know about this thing we were doing. And a judge called me over and she said, I need an hour of your time, please tell me about this. And she became a convert and she invited some other judges to meet with me over another lunch and they sort of got brought into the fold and they started putting it in orders. And the chief judge and initially said, when I approached him about it, he said, well, that's social work. We don't do social work in the criminal justice system. Within 5 years, it was in every single criminal order, no matter how serious the offense. And with that, we created the Polk County Attorney's Office, Restorative Justice Center. We approached our Board of Supervisors, the principal government funding for our county, the only primary, I guess, and said, this is important. And what we hear from victims who are dissatisfied with the criminal justice system, after they go through a restorative process, their experience of the system, their experience obtained by participating in a process is projected onto the system at large. And so what suddenly was a justice system that ignored them, they suddenly saw as being effective and positive. And by the way, and this was the pitch to the Board of Supervisors, by the way, victims vote. And and that was the approach we took. I mean, we had to take the approach, I believe, we had to take the approach, even though I had seen time and time and time again about the value of this to offenders, we had to take the approach that this is a victim. This is a program for victims. They have this need. They have the need to tell their story. They don't get it in any other place. and by the way, offenders benefit as well. And we had a PhD guy come in 6 or 7 years later to study our program. I think he looked at 100 cases over a couple of years and found, among other things, that the satisfaction rate was in excess of 90% for both victims and offenders. And, so we had some research, maybe not exhaustive, but we had a pretty good sized pool. And we built capacity. I don't know what the funding ended up being, but we built the capacity to have at least, we got funding for at least 6 full-time non-lawyers, not to be victim advocates in the sense of traditional victim advocates. We have a Polk County Victim Advocacy Center separate from the County Attorney's Office. But we created, in a sense, restorative justice paraprofessionals within the office. And I think we ended up with, there may be more now, but there were 6 when I left. 6 full-time people, and for the most part, all they did was work with victims, work with offenders, explain this process, explain the value to them. We did periodic trainings so that they could do restorative justice conversations over the telephone to explain the efficacy of these processes. And initially asking the question, what would you like justice, what should justice look like for you? You know, and that leads into a whole conversation about what's possible and what isn't. Sort of a natural segue then into restorative justice. And, we got to the point, I don't know, I can't give you the exact statistics, but roughly 1,000 to 1,200 victim offender meetings a year. So not a small program. This is one, my belief, my philosophy was every victim is entitled to this process if they want to. And we have the obligation to build capacity. Build a system that allows this for everybody that wants it. And we're getting pretty close to wrapping up, but I want to get to a little bit of the cautionary tale part of this. So my last 5 years, I switched from overseeing all the adult cases in the office. I wanted to see what would happen if we applied restorative justice principles to the juvenile justice system. Okay. And so I swapped Bureau Chief positions with a colleague, and I inherited an office that had way too many, was filing on way too many kids. I didn't know how bad it was until I took over. And I had 11 full-time prosecutors, and that's a lot of manpower, womanpower, way too much for juveniles, right? And I didn't announce it to anybody, but I had one attorney that was a good friend of mine who was the most experienced juvenile prosecutor. I said, you know what, we're going to do restorative justice work in this bureau, because prior to that, it was all done in the adult system, not in the juvenile system. Very few cases of juveniles were done. So now we're going to do this with kids. And we did 2 things. First of all, I read the law. I knew nothing about the juvenile law. So I cracked the book, and I found out in the juvenile law that there is a legal responsibility, legal duty of the juvenile court officer to go to the county attorney to ask that a detention, what we call a delinquency petition, be filed, and that they had to make a request in writing. And when they made that request in writing, they had to articulate facts not only to support that there's probable cause that this boy or girl did the offense, but they also had to articulate facts that it was in the best interest of the child that there be this filing, that the child be in formal court, and that it was also in the and also that it was in best interest of the community that the child be filed on, okay, and be in formal court. Well, we've been doing our homework around the research, you know, dangers of detention, right? There's a lot of good research on it's harmful to detain a child, and you better have a good reason for it, you know. And the deeper you put a kid into the system, the deeper that kid's going to be, you know. All pretty basic stuff, you know. And how is it that it's best for the child to be filed on if the deeper you put a child in the system, the deeper they're going to stay? And so we came up with this plan, and an acquaintance of mine was the chief public defender for Iowa, and I said, the only way we can really push back against this thing is if I can get kids lawyers before they're filed on. And I wanted to have lawyers before I made a charging decision. So I went and talked to Mark Smith, and I said, Mark, listen, I think I resolve a lot of cases if I can get juveniles, court-appointed lawyers, before I have to file a detention, a delinquency petition. So he said, yeah, makes sense. And so we started doing what I called privately restorative meetings. We publicly, I called them pre-charge meetings. And we sat around a table, charges had been filed, me, court-appointed lawyer, child, mom, dad, both, grandma sometimes, minister, therapist, juvenile court officer. And we had a conversation about not how do we punish you. The conversation was, what's in your best interest? Translate, what do you need? What do you need? Okay, what do you need? And once that was articulated collaboratively, then how do we get those needs met? Do we have to file on you? Do you need to be filed on? Do you need to be in court? Or could we do it this side of the courthouse? And the upshot of that was we reduced juvenile court filings in this county of 400,000 by 50% in about 2 years. To the point where there were four judges, they were going to reduce the number of judges to three. So that's where it was when I retired. When the year after I retired, a different philosophy came in, what I would call the punitive retributive philosophy took over, and court filings increased 150%. Two more prosecutors were added, two more full-time juvenile judges. So we have six full-time juvenile judges. How many do you have here? I bet you don't have six. Six juvenile judges. So, cautionary tale. You can't leave restorative justice just with inside the system. That's what I'm trying to get at. The community has to be involved in the update. The community has to be knocking on the door saying, we want to partner with the justice system. We've got to be part of this thing. We have a stake in this thing. And what I tell people back home and elsewhere is, you know what? You get the justice you deserve. If you don't get engaged, if you don't become active in this stuff, then you're going to get that kind of thing. You know, we're going to get more and more kids put in the system. You know, we're going to have a school-to-prison pipeline. We had the same thing happen in Des Moines that you folks experienced here. When I was doing juvenile work, I worked out a deal with the Des Moines Public Schools to put a mediator in every single high school at least one day a week. And whatever cases came along in the week that intervened, we'll mediate them. And I did one high school, 2,200 kids, Lincoln High School, and I was there every Tuesday from 10 until I got done. And we reduced school suspensions by 50%, as your project is. We reduced arrest by school resource officers by 50%. When I retired, they took the mediators out of the schools and said, it's enough if they just call us. The suspension went back up, arrest went back up. So I got involved in community organizing and began to think, what happens if you bring community organizing together with restorative justice? So it needs to happen. And so now we train people to be school mediators, to get upstream, right? You got to get upstream from the system. And so now we've got about 45 school mediators in 9 schools, and we're making headway, you know, and we're reducing suspensions again. And we started a racial profiling project, which got the attention of the police, and now we're at the table with the police. And with the police, we've set up a second chance mediation, and they refer kids directly to us to trained volunteer mediators, bypassing the juvenile justice system. Not huge numbers yet, but they've seen it works. They've seen it works, and they like the results, and they like the turnaround, and they like the satisfaction experienced by victims. By having people in the community who are competent and trained and have heart, facilitate conversations between kids and victims. And, we're also doing a really neat thing. I love doing this work. We do community justice circles, and we bring together, it's monthly so far, but we're going to increase it, primarily teenagers of color with police officers in peacemaking circles. We do them in African American churches on Monday evenings and using a talking piece, and it's phenomenal. And you got kids like this, and by the end, there's tears and there's hugs, and police officers taking kids aside and having real conversations. And so again, the cautionary tale is, absolutely, you've got to work with the system. This stuff can't work without the system. You won't get the numbers without having this be integrated in the system. You can't. I mean, you look around the country, and I looked in the 90s when we started our program, and I saw really good restorative justice work being done around the country, but they're doing 30 cases a year. How can you do 30 cases a year when you've got thousands of cases? I mean, who do you say no to, you know? And the other thing that tends to happen when it just stays out in the community is the community-based program gets the table scraps, the cases the system doesn't want anyway. They're problematic cases or whatever. So if you're gonna change the system, you've got to have these processes in the system, but you gotta be involved in the process. So right now, I work part-time in Maine with a Unitarian church-based restorative justice program. It's called the Portland Center for Restorative Justice. And what I've learned and brought to that is we sit down every Wednesday with the chief juvenile court officer and review cases, okay? And which cases are appropriate for victim offender dialogue. And so we work hand in hand with them, and we educate them in the process, and they educate us in the process. And I find that's much better than just sort of this sort of just referral out there. Oh, we don't want this case, we'll give it to the center. You know, we sit down with them and we do that. And then in Maine, the Department of Corrections oversees adults and kids. So they've seen the credibility of our work because of the results we're getting on cases and some serious cases. So now they have us teaching a restorative justice class in the state prison about 15 miles away. And so it's, you know, you have to have, the other thing we did in Des Moines, it's really, really powerful, is we do what's called court watching. We train about 120 people, retired people, college students. They go through a 2-hour training and they go down to the courthouse in pairs usually. And they've got a form and they see what's justice look like in our courtrooms. You know, what's it look like? Why do we have so many black kids and not very many white kids? You know, why are they in jumpsuits and shackles when all they did was, you know, break a window? Our thought on this, the evolution is of the thought is when it comes to the issues that you're bringing up is we have to have weight in the community, significant weight in the community, and it can't just be rabble rousers, right? You got to be competent. You got to know how the system works. Okay, got 2 minutes left. You got to know how the system works. You can't go crying out about injustice without knowing how this thing works and where it's broken, which is just about everywhere. So you have to get up to speed and be able to speak the language of the people in the system. And so we could talk about that kind of thing. So I know we've got a couple of respondents. That sounds so silly.
Dearborn, so we don't have a football program. So I'm a professor of sociology, and I actually used to, I lived in Iowa, for, I had a couple terms actually. I lived in Iowa the last time from about 2000 to 2002. And I remember at that time that Iowa actually stood out across the country. Not that there were a lot of good things, great things about Iowa, but the disparities in incarceration in Iowa were actually particularly severe. I think the black population in Iowa at that time was about 3%, and the prison population was about 50% African American. So if you can imagine that, so I was curious actually while you were talking about your efforts and how they fit, because I imagine a lot of those were coming out of Des Moines and a few other urban centers in Iowa. But I'm a sociologist by training. I got interested in restorative justice, or restorative justice became interested in me, I should say, primarily because of my work as a teacher inside the prison system. And I'm part of a program called the Inside Out Prison Exchange Program, which started in Philadelphia in the early mid-1990s, and then later became a national model. I want to point out Julia Cunha over here. I want to do that because I'm making a shameless plug for the Inside Out Prison Exchange Program. For those of you who are college instructors or qualified or want to teach college courses in a prison setting, the Inside Out Prison Exchange Program is a wonderful model, which is actually a very natural connection to restorative justice because it's a dialogic model that really involves people sitting and listening to each other and trying to understand each other's context. So when you start to understand the power of restorative justice, it really has to do with this very, very simple and essentially human encounter between people who have to look each other in the eye and hear what the other person has to say. And there's a very, there's something in us that's wired, I think, to respond to that. But I became involved in restorative justice primarily through that program and because of the men that we got to know on the inside of the prison system. And after they went through the Inside Out Prison Exchange Program, which often deals with the dynamics of incarceration, the social dynamics in our society that contribute to incarceration, and we always move towards thinking about how do we address those? What do we do about those? What are the alternatives? Are there other ways that we could approach these issues in our society? And restorative justice is often one of the models that we look at. And these men became so intrigued by the model, and they became so interested in it, they really drove us to start doing more and trying to understand more. So we have a group of men, we call them the theory group. They're a group of alumni from that have all gone through the Inside Out Prison Exchange Program. And starting around 2009, we started doing programs at the prison that were around restorative justice. It originally just started with us just wanting to know more about it. So we would just invite people to come. We call it a workshop on restorative justice. And from theory to practice, we've read about the theory group, right? Now we want to know how do people actually do this. And so through that process, we started meeting more and more people. A man named Henry McClendon, from the city of Detroit, who's actually now a program officer at the Skillman Foundation, who's passionate about restorative justice and is really devoted to making Detroit a restorative city. And has worked with schools and with the police department, is working in all sorts of different arenas in the city of Detroit. All kinds of people from the community that were doing this. As you said, it fits in all these different spaces, and all these people were enacting and implementing restorative justice in all these different places. And that then led us to trying to be proactive and trying to say, well, how do we bring restorative justice to different places? And how do we create spaces, restorative spaces, really? Because this is another similarity to Inside Out, that we noticed that with Inside Out, one of the big secrets as an instructor is that the students would come through this class, they'd go, God, what a great class. And a lot of that credit, shines on the instructor, but the open secrets about the Inside Out class is really the instructor doesn't do very much. The whole challenge in restorative justice in the Inside Out class is setting up the situation, and the students make the class happen. The students really educate each other, and they learn so much from each other that a lot of the times the best thing the professor can do is to kind of stay out of the way and let the energy of the class take over. And it's kind of like that with the restorative justice encounters that I've come to learn. But so out of this experience of doing these classes and all the interest that came out of it, and then meeting these different people from the community, we started thinking about, well, how do we take this to another level, and how do we, because the guys on the inside are saying, it's great that we're having these workshops and these discussions about restorative justice, but we want to have an impact on the world, right? And this is the one message that I also want to take out. Another reason why, if you're thinking about doing the Inside Out program, you really should, because I'm really convinced that, and I think that anybody that's met the guys that we know, and I think Julie would attest to this, that they have the capacity to heal. They have the capacity to heal this world, I'm convinced. They understand in a way like nobody can of both the harm that they've done, and also the harm of our system, of the way in which we respond. And so a part of what we're really trying to do is just unlock that potential and to bring it into more places. And so we've been trying to, they've actually initiated their own restorative justice program inside the prison now, where they're teaching classes to other incarcerated men about restorative justice. Next year they want to bring my friend Derek back in there again to give them more materials and more training so they can do more inside the prison system. And this has led to us having conversations with the Michigan Department of Corrections. And we have a couple of colleagues here from Michigan Department of Corrections here tonight, looking at ways in which we can build more spaces inside the correctional system, because we put so much money into the system, right? As Ruben indicated earlier, I mean, we are investing. We don't think of it that way, but we're investing millions and millions of dollars through our investment in corrections into the city of Detroit. Why can't we put that investment into programs that are going to have multiplier benefits instead of investing simply in the control and limitation of human beings, which is primarily what we spend those resources on. So that really has led to us getting involved in trying to work with Michigan Department of Corrections and then extending those efforts into the community through the long sort of, you know, the reach of corrections through probation and parole into the community, instead of making and working with those efforts collaboratively to think about how can we make good use of that connection or that relationship, so that we can use that to build up the relationships that will enable these men and women to re-enter their communities and to be assets to help to heal those communities, which is what so many of them want to do. And the system ends up, when they get out, the system is, you know, just reinforces the message that they're, the best thing they can do is to not commit another crime, and that they're really, you know, they're a caste, right? They're an underclass that's marked and defined that way. And so that has led to us engaging in some pilot efforts around restorative justice in the city of Detroit, working with a substance abuse treatment agency called Shafer in the city of Detroit. And so, thank you. 2 minutes. Two more minutes. No, I was actually about to wrap up. So I just want to, I'm gonna set the stage, because I didn't prepare anything. So this was really great to hear about all the models of what's taking place in other parts of the country. We met a gentleman named Don Johnson from Minnesota a few years ago that's done a lot in Hennepin County outside of Minneapolis. And so we're really interested in how this might be applied and we do actually have, through the efforts that we've made in Detroit, have met a lot of people in the legal community and in the property and community, in different legal offices, and that's sort of a new territory for us. But we're really interested not only in what we can do to build these programs and spaces inside corrections and back into the community and connecting the two, but also, as Mr. Summers was saying, going back to the front end as well. So we're doing this at the front end and the back end. And so it was through these efforts that I got to know my friend Derek Frank here, who at the time was at Indiana University. What's the full name of that? Indiana University, IUPUI, Purdue University, Indianapolis, right? We just call it Ooey Pooey, that's what I call it. And he had done a lot of, I had heard about him actually before I ever met him because of the work they had done inside the Indiana Department of Corrections. And so it was actually a blessing to us, we felt, when he decided, along with his wife Carol, who's sitting on us as well, to relocate to the state of Michigan a couple years ago. And since Derek has gotten here, we've really actually, I think, been able to take a lot of our efforts in terms of trying to institutionalize restorative justice, although I'm hesitant to say that, because I think some of the power of restorative justice is that it comes from a grassroots place, and that it's organic and communal and not an institutional program, right, that has like a set structure to it, but that it's very flexible and malleable. But Derek has been invaluable in us being able to kind of really learn more about what we're doing and what it is we're trying to do. And so I think that's probably in the last 2 minutes. So I'm going to hand it over to Derek.
My name is Derek, and I work at Michigan State. And I've been involved in restorative justice now for 10 years. I have an academic background, and I have a job in an academic department. But the word Fred used, magic, is true. I don't use that word too often in my job, but when you facilitate these sorts of processes, when you see what happens in restorative justice, whether it's as a diversion from court, whether it's post-sentence, whether it's, in my case, on the back, the far back end, with prisoner reentry, you see magic happen. The story at the synagogue is not the exception to the rule. This is a very common outcome that you see. One of my first cases that I had in the adult correctional system in Indiana was a manslaughter case, and the mother of the woman who died wanted to confront the offender. This was 4 years after the offense. And after that 2-3 hour conference, she said it was the first night in 4 years that she'd slept all the way through the night. She travels with me to talk to departments of correction, to police, to schools, to anyone who will listen to say, this is something that if it could work for me, it can work for anybody. So these are the stories that you hear. Paul and I and some other colleagues approach it from a few different angles, and one of those is an empirical angle. Well, what can we say about the effectiveness of restorative justice? And so I've been involved in a number of research projects and outcome evaluations, looking at what does everybody want to know? Does this reduce offending for offenders? And does it increase healing for victims? And we see time and time again research showing that it does. We just had some, actually unveil this tonight, but we analyzed some of the numbers from our Indiana study and found that in our pilot group of 15 guys who went through conferencing, zero of them had reoffended within 3 years of getting out. And of the 12 in the control group, 8 had been reincarcerated within 3 years. So I think now is the time. I keep finding myself surrounded by blue and maize. Is it maize or is it maize?
Maize.
Yeah.
Rose Bowl.
Well, I'm a 49ers fan, so I know a little bit about your new head coach, and good luck. There's a movement. I mean, I'm convinced there's been a movement growing since the 1970s with this, but I think now, I feel, it's amazing that so many people are here tonight for this. It's amazing that I'm constantly being approached by people like Fred and like Paul and like folks from the Department of Correction who are here. Let's not under... This is amazing, right? So so that's what I do. I advise, I train, I conference, I see the magic. I've done about 200 of these victim offender conferences inside prisons, from very minor drug cases where, listen, people have been affected, families have been affected. We use this as a tool for family reunification, for reentry, going home. We know that social bonds matter for our men and women before they leave correctional facilities. What are we doing? What are we doing to help victims? What are we doing to empower offenders? What are we doing to repair the harm? And to me, that's what it all boils down to. So I took, actually, just to finish here, the Inside Out training that Paul is talking tonight. It's really a great process. And I'll be teaching my first class at Cooper Street Prison in Jackson next fall, dealing specifically with restorative justice. And at the end of that class, we'll have a group of trained restorative justice facilitators. Half of them will be inmates and half of them will be Michigan State students. So I think it's, I'm honored to be here as well. Look forward to seeing where Michigan goes with this. I saw where Indiana, of all places, could go with this. I look forward to seeing where Michigan goes.
Questions, responses, for maximum participation, if you can keep them brief, that would be wonderful. There's a microphone over there. So, first question, response. Yes?
I want to... Hello? Since we want to encourage as many people to be involved in this process as possible, I was thinking about some of the barriers, psychological barriers that have come up for me in thinking about working in prisons. So one of the first questions, as somebody who's a white person, is wondering, does it make any difference of person's race or gender as to the effectiveness of being a facilitator? And second, could you talk a little bit about the process of people being involved in the prisons for those of us that have never actually walked into a prison itself?
Well, in my experience, the short answer to your first question is no. In Indiana prisons demographically resemble, I think, other states, including Michigan. I was one of a number of facilitators there, mostly white. We trained a number of correctional officers to do these conferences, a number of counselors to do these conferences. I mean, in my experience, when it gets, at least in the tail end, when it gets down to offenders volunteering for this process, it's such an incredibly hard decision for them to make, that this becomes about the harm that they've caused and the people that they're confronting more than anything else, and in my experience.
Is this on? So on the issue of going into the prison system, if you haven't been in the system before, I mean, I think there is, it's similar to me, like when we take, I teach at the University of Michigan Dearborn, and I also do urban sociology courses where we go in the city of Detroit, and a lot of our students have a distorted view of the city, let's put it that way. And so I think there's a way to kind of prepare them for that, but also there's a way to process it, that the Inside Out program is actually very, very deliberate about this and how it's done. So we spend a lot of time, we spend a certain amount of time talking to people about what it's going to be like and what they're going into prison for and what they're not going into prison for. They're not going into prison, it's not a scared straight experience. They're not going there to try to save anybody or rescue anybody or to perform charity work. They're not going there to study people. They're not going there to do research on people. And they're not going there to be whistleblowers against the particular, you know, the institution that we're going into, the facility that we're going into. And then after they go in and they've had an experience, then we spend time debriefing the experience. We also do the same thing with the inside students. And so as the question of the race of facilitator, I'm a sociologist, so I would never say that it doesn't matter. I think it probably does matter. But I think that in other words, that the experience would be different. And I think that I can't speak to what that would mean and how that would be different. I would say that one thing that people in prison, they pick up on bullshit really fast. I think that if you're genuine and honest with people and straightforward with people and you're non-judgmental, I think that's something that they respect, regardless of who you are and where it is, coming from. And I think, but that's something that needs to be, again, that needs to be very deliberate. And also we need to monitor ourselves. We need to monitor ourselves in terms of how we react. And in the Inside Out program, I keep referring to that because I think that to me provides a kind of a baseline for a lot of how I think about interacting in those with individuals in those environments, is that we spend a lot of time checking ourselves on things like othering language, labeling language. Like, you made a distinction between offenders and victims. And we talk about inside students and outside students. We don't say the criminals or the inmates or the prisoners, because these are, and when you go inside the prison, that's the only words that the prison administration uses. And you'll notice that as you're someone going into the prison. You'll even say to them, say, well, I have a student in the class with this name, and they'll come back and they'll say, oh, do you mean prisoner so-and-so, right? So it's like almost like a deliberate thing. They're deliberately rejecting your attempt to humanize that individual. So not reduce them to the label identity of being a prisoner or an offender, right? Or a victim, because I think part of the issue that one of the things that restorative justice helps victims to do is to stop being trapped always in that moment of having been a victim, of having been at somebody else's mercy, right? It enables them to move beyond that. Our friend Henry McClendon always talks about people playing back the tape. And people can be in this perpetual state of playing back the tape. And that includes the offender and the victim. And one thing the restorative justice process can enable is to sort of free them from that. But I think being very, very conscious of the way in which you categorize people and their behavior is something that comes along with the training in restorative justice, just as it does with Inside Out. And so one of the things that we've talked about with Michigan Department of Corrections is that Inside Out might be a kind of a portal to restorative justice in the state, and we're hoping that something might come of that. I want to say again that we're doing an info session on December 5th about Inside Out, and Julia there has flyers.
Just real quick. My experience in doing trainings in jails and prisons, first of all, is they're hungry for outsiders to come in. They're hungry for outsiders to come in, people who come in hopefully without an agenda, people with heart, you know. And they're hungry for ideas. They're hungry to have conversations. So I'm familiar with the Inside Out program. It's a great program. I met the founder a few months ago at a thing in Ohio. Great program. I don't do that. I teach a restorative justice class. I use Howard Jarrett's little book of restorative justice. It's a nice thing. We do poetry. We do writing. We do role plays. And I was blown away the first time I was asked by a couple of inmates who were at a jail, and they'd been there 2 years. They were waiting trial on federal. I didn't realize the feds could have me. In Iowa, you can't be in jail more than a year, but the feds can keep you in jail as long as they want it. I was approached by a couple men after the first couple of hours of training. They said, we want to know what it's like to be the victim, our victim. How can that happen? I said, well, the only real way to happen, I think, is to have a victim-centered dialogue, which we talked about. But I said, short of that, I said, maybe we could do some role plays. We got permission from that jail to come back a month later and do an all-day thing where we actually role played. The very first one I did was a federal bank robbery in which the bank robber played the bank teller. And he was crying by the end. He said, I had no idea. I had no idea until I actually sat in the place. And other members who were just observing the role play were crying as well. So we use a lot of role play now. It's somewhere in the process too. They want that.
Question?
Yes, I would like to ask about women offenders, because the number of women being incarcerated in this country is going up rapidly. And I was part of a gospel study that our moderator Joe Summers did in the Michigan prison for women for 20 years. And women seem to me to come in for different kinds of crimes, And we certainly met women who felt that they would be dead if they weren't in prison, given the circumstances that they had come in for. And there are different kinds of crimes as well. Women who kill their husbands after years of abuse from the husbands. Women who kill their babies. And those are the really severe. But there are a lot of women who were there for being repeat offenders, habitual offenders, who were in for small crimes that were nonviolent. So it seems to me it's a different population, and I just wanted to know if you've worked with women and if you see the differences that I just experienced.
So we get in a couple more questions, so how about just brief responses on kind of restorative practices of women?
I have not. I think it's a great question. And the women you mentioned, most of them are probably still going to go home at some point. And so the question is, what are we offering them? What space are we creating for them? Whether or not that involves the man, if it was a domestic violence case. But what are we doing to try to repair any harm that's maybe been caused by the incarceration itself? To repair relationships before they go home. I think that's where restorative justice can maybe relate in these cases, is to building back those bonds to society, to family, before they're released. And I think in that case, it's less of a victim-offender mediation, right? And more of a reentry-based, holistic approach to repair.
The one thing I would say about my colleague who recently retired, Professor Laura Lunter, was very, in fact, she's the one that started the Inside Out program at my university. Before she started the Inside Out program, she was very, very active at the Women's Huron Valley facility, which is the facility for women in the state of Michigan. And over the years, they brought in many, many other faculty professors to do programs there. And so they actually have a lot of programming that takes place there. And recently, they invited some of our theory group members to come and speak to them about restorative justice. So I know they're just as hungry for it there as in other places. I mean, I guess I'd say the advantage, if you can call it that, in Michigan is that you have one facility where all the women in the system are. And so if you can create a program there, you would be impacting that population. But I agree with Derek. I think that the issues are distinctive and that the need is just as great. And so we need to think about it.
My only experience in the prisons is doing some, for lack of a better term, co-ed trainings in jails, male, female, together, but not working with females separately. Certainly been a participant in a lot of victim offender meetings or dialogues in which women have been the individual causing the harm. And the process allows them to talk about many of the things that you're concerned about.
You know, I wanted to jump in. I'm trying to, I didn't want to jump in because I'm not supposed to be doing that.
No, you're welcome. But,
it's such a great question. It seems like the prime opportunity for the front end restorative justice diversion kind of tactic. I mean, if you have a woman who's potentially going to be sentenced for murder, this seems like the time to activate some of this early prosecutorial work that you discussed. In fact, it seems like this population is the ideal population because of the kinds of crimes that were just mentioned. Yeah, in my mind.
So at the time, Huron Valley Women's was the maximum security women's prison in the state when there was 3 women's prisons, and the majority of women were there on shoplifting, prostitution, and bad check writing. Also, you know the majority of women lifers are there because of crime, murders their husbands or partners committed when they were around. So, I mean, there's a wide open camp. I didn't want to say it didn't get emphasized here as much, but the restorative justice process also involves the community taking responsibility for what the person who's committed the harm needs in order to not commit harm again in the future. That's a vital element also missing in our discussion. Yeah?
I just wanted to say that while we're looking in Washtenaw County about our prison population or our pre-prison population, we should also look within our schools, the whole entire county. I am with Ypsilanti Community Schools, and Fred, I was thinking to get comments with Washtenaw. Ypsilanti is an even better word. But Ypsilanti Community Schools 3 years ago instituted restorative practices from the Institute of the International Institute of Restorative Practices, which I'm sure you're aware of in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. I'm one of the trainers in the district, and our teachers are seeing results. This is our third year of implementation. But most importantly, as we look at our children in our classrooms, even as young as our kindergarten children, restorative practices is a way for them to say, I'm sorry, so that the doer is able to say to the person who's the receiver of the harm that I am sorry. So I encourage our county to look at all of our school districts. This is a program, whether it's restorative practices or restorative justice, that should be operational.
Thank you, and thank you for that work, too. Other questions? Are folks, what are the major obstacles towards us moving towards a restorative justice system in this county?
I'd like to ask about the accountability of the consistency from the education in prison to the such kind of the activity, because I know the importance of the such kind of consistency to the rehabilitate the offenders or juvenile crime offenders, but the understanding of other people is not enough, I believe. Especially in my country, such kind of understanding is not enough, so I need the reinforce of the, such kind of understanding through the law education or other kind of the education. So do you have any idea to the facilitate such kind of understanding for the other people, especially other than the law enforcement officers?
So just repeat the first part of your question.
The question is how many people how do you facilitate the understanding of the other people's of these activities?
So, talking about communicating the value to the broader public, I think that is a major issue because until people have like experienced it, you do have a kind of an initial response that why would a victim ever want to do that, right? Why would a victim? How is a victim going to benefit from that? I think that gets to the point that Fred was making that really important, that the people that have been through the process, I mean, they have to come to. You have to build a constituency, so you can't just be, if you want to change the system, and I really kind of wanted to return to the question you answered at the beginning, because as a sociologist, in a sense, I started out by asking about the disparities in Iowa. That's how I came, to thinking about, came at the prison issue first, was thinking about it from the level of mass incarceration and this systemic problem, and as you mentioned, restorative justice is often this very, very intimate, micro-level phenomenon. And it can be difficult to communicate what happens there in a way that has the same power as the dominant narrative, which is really one of about fear of crime, right? And how we need to be tough on crime. I don't know of a place where that in the United States. I think that's really an intrinsically difficult problem because all politics are local, and even when you have a consensus building at a national level, which we seem to have now, where you have people on the right and people on the left are talking about how it's time for criminal justice reform, that it's still very, very difficult to move things forward at the state level or the local level because every politician is worried about the one case that's going to happen in their district where somebody goes through this process and then goes on to commit another horrible crime, and you know, and this is going to appear to be soft on crime. So I think Derek, though, talks, one of the things that's really important to emphasize about the restorative justice process is that it's not easy. It's not at all easy, and in some ways, it's actually a much more difficult process for offenders to go through. I don't know, Derek could probably speak to that.
Oh, I mean, they tell me it's the hardest thing they've done since they've been incarcerated. Most of them want to back out of this process. It's voluntary, they sign up, but 2 days before the conference, I don't know if I can do this.
Sweating,
they're pacing, they're preparing notes, even if it's just their family coming to the conference, and there's no direct victim involved. So we allow for that as well, and in the end we did. But I wanted to touch on a piece, you said consistency in getting the message across. And that's important because having a shared understanding of just what the term means, restorative justice, is critical to me. In Indiana, we had a juvenile prison, a juvenile correctional facility, and every year they had a victims awareness week, and they planted a tree, and they released balloons. And they said, look, we're doing restorative justice because we released some balloons and we planted a tree. Okay. Restorative-ish, perhaps. But I read that. I didn't make up that term. I read it the other day. It might have been Zara that said restorative-ish. But the consistency part is key. What are we doing to repair harm? Is releasing balloons repairing harm? To hold offenders accountable? To increase healing for victims? To facilitate successful reintegration? To involve the community in this response. So it's those key pillars that need to all be hit for a program to be fully restorative.
One thing I'd add, a couple of things in terms of the soft on crime thing, and I've experienced the same thing you have in pre-prison, talking to inmates in jail. Their attorneys give me the opportunity to talk to them, to explain the process to them. And I don't know how many times they would say, I can't do it, man. I'd rather stay here. You know, they oftentimes do it, but they don't experience it as being soft on crime or being let off. So there's that piece. The other thing I think is sort of the pebble in the pond thing. When we got started, I didn't mention this in my early remarks, but one of the critical things was getting public defenders to sit at the table, part of the process, but keeping their mouths shut, which is really hard for a defense attorney to not talk, because they're the mouthpiece for their clients. But usually that, sitting in on one or two with a client, seeing the power of it, and coming out of it saying, yeah, man, I really like it that my client has to be accountable. You know, and that's a nice movement when you get a defense attorney saying, yeah, it's a good thing, my client being accountable. And then they begin to spread the word. So, and I guess all I could say is the more time we have these individual processes take place, the more opportunity there is for the word to get out. And so you can't do it in a soundbite, you know. You can do some good reading, but participate, perhaps be allowed to observe. You know, we let people, students, observe with the permission of everybody. And that was done from time to time. Defense attorneys are good ambassadors, and they're becoming good ambassadors for it. Just the more you do of it, the more it gets out.
Okay, quick question, but we gotta go.
I think it's important because we have two esteemed colleagues from the Michigan Department of Correction with us, the corrections, Indiana's correction, Indiana's corrections. Fred, just in general, is there any advice you would give our guests from the department here tonight? I know you spoke about we can't leave RJ just within the system, the importance of involving the community. Just is there anything in general you'd like to say to our guests?
Well, I guess one thing, and this is a really disturbing thing that just happened 2 weeks ago, is they took away funding. The DOC at the prison level took away funding for victim offender panels. And the reason is that they they didn't believe there was research to show that they had that interest. And I really hate it when people tie restorative justice to recidivism. It may impact recidivism, but that's not why that shouldn't be the number one reason we do. We do it because there's a human need for these people to come together. And if there's less crime as a result, fantastic. We shouldn't be saying we're going to do these things because we have less crime. That sounds wonderful, but that's not the victim. Victim has a need separate. The victim doesn't want the offender to commit another offense, certainly. But the victim isn't coming to the table ostensibly in order to impact the offender so the offender doesn't commit a crime. The victim comes to the table, comes into the circle, because the victim has needs specific to the harm caused. So I don't know if that's advice or not, but I know that's an issue that, for years we had victim impact panels, and they did them really well. We had a great state. We had a director of restorative practices in the prison system, and they have to take it partly because of who our governor is, I think.
It's in Iowa?
In Iowa, yeah.
I'm afraid we've run out of time, and so first let's have a big hand. I hope you fill out the form in your program, sign the petition, get the poster for the next event. Also, pick up books on your way out in the back. And lastly, we have an announcement from We Rock. Quickly, come up.
Hi, my name is Aaron Schulton, and this is Jane Wong. We are students at the School of Public Health, and we'd like to take this opportunity to invite you to the We Rock public meeting next month. We Rock is the Washtenaw Regional Organizing Coalition comprised of faith, labor, and community organizations. And what it is coming together hundreds of members of the community, since there's strength in numbers, and we're going to ask public officials for support in pushing back against mass incarceration and mass deportation, support for economic dignity, earned sick time, alternatives to school suspensions, and also public transit from Washtenaw County to Detroit. So we have flyers on the back table. 2 hours of every time on a Sunday afternoon, and my email's on there. If you have anyone you want to share the flyer with, please contact me. We'll push it out to you. Thank you.
We Rock is the same kind of faith-based community organization that Fred's part of in Des Moines that's been pushing for this. I do want to say, just so you're aware, we have 10,000 people fewer in our state prisons than we did 5 years ago. And that decrease happened without an increase in crime and with actually lowering recidivism at the same time. The state legislature is currently considering cutting down another 10,000. So we are in the midst of big, big changes. It's time for us all to show up and try to see how we can make these changes as humane as possible and make them as successful as possible. Thank you all again.